Hi guys, and welcome back to another episode of my Pokemon Battle Series, The School of Hard Knocks. So throughout this episode, like every other, we'll be jumping on to the Pokemon Global Link Battle Spot Ladder, playing under the Championship Battle Rules, which are the equivalent rule set of the VGC 2017 season. So, we started the week off yesterday with a brand new team, had a bit of a shaky start. It didn't go completely to plan, but and we had a couple of drawn out games as well that kind of went on a bit longer than what we kind of wanted them to. So hopefully we have a bit of a quicker episode today, just include a couple of games and kind of showcase a few more things about the team. So to run through the team again quickly, just before we get into any battles, we'll just cover it quickly. And we are running Araquanid, Tapu Koko, Arcanine, Magnezone, Alolan Persian, and Porygon 2. So our rating at the minute, 1652, it's not brilliant, but we're kind of slowly creeping up the ladder, and hopefully we'll be able to kind of showcase the team and get a couple of wins under our belt today and just head towards that 1700. We should be finding stronger opponents as well, so hopefully the battles are a bit more higher quality for yourselves. The other thing yesterday was I was feeling really under the weather, so I've not really been 100% in my mind. So I think the team review episode probably showed that slightly, and also yesterday's battle as well. Just not really thinking concisely and making bad decisions in team preview. And it just kind of goes to show as well that you've got to really be on point in team preview to make sure you're making those right decisions. So hopefully we can do that today, because we've got our first opponent and they are running a team of Smeagol, Feramosa, Gigalith, Celesteela, Alolan Marowak, and Porygon Z. So let us see how we can tackle this. We've got to be careful for the Smeagol with the Spore. We learned a hard lesson yesterday with that Hypnosis from the Driplim, so Tapu Koko might be very good in this match here. We would need to watch out for that Marowak though, so that's something to keep in mind. Now, let's think. What can we do? I do like Tapu Koko, so I think I might lead with Tapu Koko here. I've also got to be careful at Porygon Z as well, because that could be potentially scarfed and start doing a lot of damage. I think I'm going to lead Tapu Koko Arcanine. I do like Magnezone here as well. And I think I'm going to round things off with... Actually, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to bring Persian, Arcanine, and... Yeah, I am going to bring the Magnezone as well. Seems a bit strange bringing the double electric to an opponent that is potentially bringing Marowak to the game, but the Alolan Persian provides a lot of support with the foul play against it, and we've got the Arcanine as well that can cycle those Intimidates. So I feel like having a faster Fake Out user to kind of go into this first turn is going to be a lot more beneficial, especially if that Feramosa leads or the Smeagol leads as well. But we do see the Smeagol and the Porygon Z lead, so... Now we can Fake Out that Smeagol just to prevent it doing anything this turn, or we can kind of go for the Porygon Z. Now I'm quite tempted just to go for that Porygon Z, so a Fake Out and a Volt Switch into it. Because if that Smeagol goes for a Fake Out, it can't go for a Spore. If it does go for a Fake Out, it's just a dead turn, so we can go into that next turn and plan around that. Porygon Z actually protects, so we're doubling into it, wasting a turn here, and the Smeagol just protects as well. So going for that Baneful Bunker, and Baneful Bunker, so if we attacked into that, we would have been poisoned, and that's the kind of after effect of that move. So we are going to see a Moody boost from that Smeagol, so its speed does rise. And I wonder here if that Porygon Z is going to go for a Trick Room, and the Smeagol maybe just going for a Follow Me. Regardless of that, I am just going to Volt Switch into it again, and at this time I'm going to Parting Shot into the Porygon Z with my Alolan Persian. So we know it's not outspeeding us, we know it's not scarfed because it has revealed the Protect already, so we should be outspeeding it, we should be able to get the Volt Switch into it, and the Parting Shot as well. So we just do see the Follow Me from the Smeagol. which I'm totally fine with, because what we'll do, we'll bring in the Magnezone into this slot. Take Smeagol down to its sash. So we'll bring in... Do I want to bring in the Arcanine in that slot? No, I am going to bring in the Magnezone on that slot. And we'll just get this parting shot, which isn't really affecting the Smeagol too much. And we probably will see a Trick Room come out from this Porygon Z, I'd imagine. So that's one of the reasons why I will bring in my Arcanine here. And we'll see what this Porygon Z goes for. Yeah, and we just see the Trick Room. So now we do need to be very careful of the the potential Z move coming out from that Porygon Z. So could have the Z Hyper Beam or something like that. And I would imagine it would probably target into this Arcanine. So what I'm going to do is just go for a Flash Cannon into this Smeagol, and I'm going to protect my Arcanine this turn just to preserve it and potentially waste the Z move from that Porygon Z. But we do see a Protect come out from that Porygon Z, so kind of playing into our Protect here. We do get the Flash Cannon off into the Smeagol. Because of that speed boost, we are going to be outspeeding it in Trick Room, which is fine, and we'll see what my opponent brings in here. So potentially will be that Gigalith. Yeah, and it is the Gigalith. So we do need to be careful of the potential Earthquake coming out. So I think I'm going to just go for Magnet Rise, and I am going to I'm going to go for a Will-O-Wisp onto the Gigalith as well. So if it does go for the Earthquake, Arcanine should be able to take this. We've got to remember that Magnezone has the sturdy ability, so we'll be able to take at least one Earthquake and get that Magnet Rise off going into the next turns. But if we can get a Will-O-Wisp onto this Gigalith now, it's going to be huge. Again, we need to be careful for that Porygon Z firing off a big Z move. Did you see the Rock Slide come out from Gigalith? Does massive damage to Arcanine, so that indicates that it might be banded. Does proc our berry, so as long as we don't flinch here, we should be alright. Get the Magnet Rise off. But we don't really, it was a bit wasteful now because, yeah, and now we see the Z move come out from this Porygon Z. I wonder if it's going to be into the Magnezone slot, because potentially thinking that he will get the KO onto the Arcanine with that Rock Slide, maybe not wanting to waste it and go for the Porygon Z as an alternative, which is better for us, because we should be able to take it if it is into the it is into the Arcanine slot. That's a bit of a shame. So we won't get the Will-O-Wisp off, but we can bring the Persian back in now, which is the big thing. So we can get a Fake Out off onto that Gigalith and get a Flash Cannon into it as well. Which is huge, because if it is Choice Banded, then it can't protect. And I would imagine from the damage that we saw there, it can't protect. So we might be right. So we do get the Fake Off up onto the Gigalith, does flinch, and we get that Flash Cannon, more importantly, onto the Gigalith slot. Yeah, do about half health, so that's not too bad. And we see a Hyper Beam come out from the Porygon Z. Is going to be into the Persian, and that will take us down. But that's not the worst case in the world. We've still got our Tapu Koko to bring in, and that Porygon Z cannot move this next turn. So what we can do is protect our Tapu Koko from the Rock Slide and pick up the KO onto the Gigalith. So the only thing that can really go wrong for us here is a potential flinch on our Magnezone. So we've got to kind of keep our fingers crossed we don't get flinched, from the Gigalith here. Do take the rock slide. Come on, no flinch. Brilliant. So, we get the flash cannon off, take care of the Gigalith. And we'll see what my opponent's last Pokemon is. And I don't know how many turns of... Yeah, so that's a Trick Room ended as well. So that's nice. Going into this next turn, we can double into that Porygon Z potentially. And it is the Feromosa. Okay. So, what I'm going to do here is just go for a Protect. And I could just go for... See, my opponent could protect the Feromosa here, expecting the Dazzling Gleam, and go for the Hyper Beam into the Tapu Koko. So I think what I'm going to do is go for the Twinkle Tackle into that Porygon Z and hope that it's enough to take it out. We haven't seen the Feromosa protect. It does go for a High Jump Kick. Okay. We'll take a lot of damage from that. And we are going to get a Z move off. Now we need this to KO, because if this doesn't KO, we're in a really bad situation. We will go down to a High Jump Kick on our Magnezone, so that Feromosa will be able to clean up the battle. So we need to make sure that we are taking this Porygon Z out here. So hopefully, come on, Tapu Koko with your Twinkle Tackle. It's like the friendliest Z move in the game, but hopefully it's enough. Oh, it's not enough. Oh, this is the worst. Okay, so I think we're going to lose this, because this Hyper Beam will take us down. Right. Yeah. Okay. We would have been better off going just for the Dazzling Gleam there, getting rid of the Feromosa, but I was very wary about the Protect from that Feromosa, so that's why I made that play. If I hadn't protected the Magnezone there, then, you know, we would have went down. All I can really do here is... Well, I could go for a double Protect, or I could go for a Miss. So, let's think. I've probably got more chance to get the double Protect off than I have the move missing. So, I'm going to go for the double Protect, and hopefully Magnezone. Yeah, the odds are better in my favor if I go for the double Protect here, so I'm going to just click in with that. Lucky number 7, hopefully, come on. We get it. Magnezone goes for the Protect. It fails. High Jump Kick. And it does hit. So, it's a bit unfortunate. Very unfortunate. Yeah, I should have went for the Dazzling Gleam there. We would have got rid of the Feromosa, and then we would have been able to easily deal with that Porygon Z with our Magnezone. Just a bit cautious, I think. You know, as I said, if that Feromosa had protected there and we went for the Dazzling Gleam, that wouldn't have been enough by itself to take out the Porygon Z, so we would have still taken a Hyper Beam from it, KO'd, and we would have been in the same situation anyway. So we had to hope that the Twinkle Tackle was enough to KO, but it unfortunately wasn't, so that's not ideal. But good game to my opponent anyway, and we'll move into game 2. So just a bit unfortunate there. We'll click in with Galadian for this next game. So yeah, not going as well as what I kind of planned. I think I've still got to get kind of to grips with the team and just, you know, figure some things out with it. But it's there are ways to play it, and hopefully we kind of get into those throughout these episodes, and we get to grips with how to play things. So we have our next opponent playing a team of Alolan Persian, Tapu Fini, Arcanine, Cortana, Tapu Koko, and Snorlax. So, how are we going to approach this one? Tapu Koko is very good here. Puts a lot of pressure on the Tapu Fini, puts a lot of pressure onto the Persian. Can hit the Cortana for good damage, the Arcanine for good damage. And we have the potential to kill opposing Tapu Kokos with our Twinkle Tackle. So I definitely want to bring the Tapu Koko here. I think I definitely want to bring my Persian here, my Arcanine, and it's down to this last slot. So who do we want? Magnezone, possibly. Magnezone's very good against Finny. We have to be careful for the Arcanine. The Kartana and the Snorlax, really. And then we've got the Araquanid. I think I might go Araquanid here because we've got the Bug Bite that can really neuter the Snorlax and take advantage of its berry. We can hit the Arcanine hard, the Persian hard, and we resist anything that the Tapu Fini throws at us. So we'll lock in with that and we'll see how we get on. I don't feel like we need the speed control here for what we're using the Araquanid for. Putting a lot of pressure on to things like the Arcanine, and we're going to be outspeeding the Snorlax in whatever situation anyway, so we'll see how we get on. Hopefully a little bit better than that last game. Porygon Z is ridiculous. It's so powerful, and it was just being overcautious that last turn. We should have just went for the straight dazzling game. That would have been enough to kill that Feramosa, and then the game would have been ours. So you live and learn, guys. That's the main thing. Not to let these losses get to you. Just pick up the best parts from the battle. See where you can improve and then go from there. So we see my opponent lead off with their Arcanine and Tapu Koko. And we lead off with our Tapu Koko and our Persian. So we are threatened straight away from the opposing Tapu Koko onto our Persian. With a potential Dazzling Gleam or Twinkle Tackle. But I think what I'll do, I'll just go for a Twinkle Tackle myself into that Tapu Koko slot. And I'm going to go for a Fake Out into the Arcanine just to stop it getting off any attacks at this turn. If it is a speed tie between the Tapu Kokos, if we win, we should be able to pick up the KO pending it's not a sashed variant or not. But I'm quite confident just going into this turn. I mean, Persian should be able to survive at least one Dazzling Gleam, even a Life Orb Dazzling Gleam. So we should be alright going into this turn and going for this play. It's not risking too much and the reward is quite good. So we just see the Tapu Koko actually just protect. And the Arcanine protect as well, just to burn that any potential fake out coming out from the Persian. But we are going for the Z move, so we will be able to get at least some damage on this Tapu Koko this turn. It's not going to be a great deal. Probably looking at about 25% through the protect. Just going to make it a little bit difficult to get rid of this Tapu Koko now. Because it's the main thing. We need to get rid of the Tapu Koko, then an Araquanid can come in and start taking advantage of that. So I think what I'll do is just go for a Volt Switch into the Tapu Koko and a Parting Shot as well. Like I say, hopefully Persian gets through this turn alright. Oh, this is terrible. So, our internet drops out. Yeah, and it is us, so super sorry about this, guys. We'll jump straight back onto the ladder. And hopefully, we don't have any more issues finding an opponent. It's weird when you build a new team. I don't know if you guys get this sometimes, but when you kind of build a new team and you play it, I don't know, I normally get this sense of like real comfort with a team or sense of not so much comfort with the team, and a bit wary of how it's kind of playing, because you can put a team together on paper and everything seems fine, and it's not until you kind of get into your battles and start playing with it and putting things into practice that you really find out if the team operates as well as what you kind of initially thought. And I'm not feeling massively confident with this team, if I'm totally honest with you, which is a bit strange, because I normally feel a lot more confident with going into like every match than I do with this team. And I don't know whether it's because I'm just not playing it as optimally as it needs to be played. The game that we just dropped out of there, my opponent going for a double protect and then wasting the Z move. It's not really getting the most out of the team in that sort of situation. So I'm not really sure. I think I probably need a bit more confidence with the team, feel a bit more confident with how I'm playing, and then hopefully the kind of results will follow with that. And that's just something for you guys to kind of consider as well. But sometimes it's good to just play a team if you're still not feeling it and it's not kind of suiting how you want to play your games, then just put it to one side. Like I say, there's no harm in putting something to one side, leaving it till a later date and then coming back to it, and maybe just pulling ideas out from it and then putting them again into a new set of six. So it's just stuff to think about. But we have our next opponent, so hopefully we don't get any disconnects this time. So sorry about that, guys. And they are running a team of Golduck, Pelipper, Kartana, Tapu Koko, Incineroar, and Palisand. So quite an interesting team here, especially with the Incineroar and Palisand. We have the Rain Core that's going to put on a lot of pressure straight away, that we do need to be quite careful of. But we do have our Araquanid that can take good advantage of the rain that we might do. So I think what I'll do here is actually lead off with my Porygon 2 and my Persian. I think I will bring the Araquanid, and what about the last slot? Tapu Koko could be quite nice here, but then so could Magnezone, because Magnezone is going to be able to kind of wall the Tapu Koko, threatens both Golduck and Pelipper quite hard. The Incineroar is a bit of a threat. And so is a Kartana. I think I'm going to just actually opt for Tapu Koko in my last slot. So I keep that in the back until late game and then bring it in, and hopefully we can kind of just clean up with that at the very end. You do need to be careful of that Incineroar as well. It will carry Fake Out, so we need to be aware of that. But I'm kind of expecting my opponent to lead with his Rain mod here. But we don't. We see the Incineroar and we see the shiny Tapu Koko. So we'll lead off with our Persian and our Porygon 2. So we can go for the Fake Out into the Tapu Koko here. Oh, come on, internet. Don't do this. Right, okay, we're back in. Yeah, we can fake out into the Tapu Koko, and that Incineroar can fake out into our Porygon 2. And let me kind of just burn a turn, really. I think I'm just going to go for a Thunderbolt into the Incineroar here, and I am going to just go for a Fake Out into that Tapu Koko. And we'll see what my opponent goes for. So we do get the Fake Out off onto the Tapu Koko, break any potential sashes, but yeah, we're just going to switch and just trade Fake Outs here. So it's a bit of a dead turn, and we'll go on to this next turn to see what we can do. Now we do need to be careful of the Dazzling Gleam from this Tapu Koko. Could potentially have Taunt as well, but I think I'm just going to go for the Trick Room, and I'm going to go for a Parting Shot into the Incineroar. Yeah, I'm going to go for a Parting Shot into the Incineroar rather than a Tapu Koko. So we actually outspeed the Tapu Koko on my opponent's end. We get the Parting Shot off, and we'll be able to take our Persian back. Now the issue here is, if my opponent has went for the Thunderbolt into that Persian slot, but I'd imagine he's more inclined to go for a Dazzling Gleam, so I will switch in my Araquanid here. It is a little bit risky, especially because we didn't go for the Parting Shot onto the Tapu Koko, so we could potentially lose our Araquanid here, and that's going to be huge. But we do see the Dazzling Gleam, thankfully. So both Pokemon able to take that quite nicely. And we'll see what this Incineroar goes for. Just goes for a Darkest Lariat, and it will be into that Porygon 2 slot. And we are able to take that quite comfortably, which is nice. So we get the Trick Room up, and game is on. So, this next turn, I think I am just going to go for a Thunderbolt into the Incineroar, and I'm going to go for a Hydro Vortex into the Tapu Koko slot. So even if it protects, we're going to do good damage to it, and anything kind of switching in on that slot, we're going to be picking up a lot of damage. So it's just making sure that we are getting as much damage and potentially picking up a KO like we're going to here. We don't see the protect come out from the Tapu Koko, so we will get this Hydro Vortex into that slot. We don't need to worry too much about the Incineroar at this point because it's not going to be hitting Araquanid for too much damage. I've jinxed myself by using it in this team. Araquanid. But there we go. So we pick up the KO onto the Tapu Koko. And we'll get a Thunderbolt off onto this Incineroar, which will be boosted by the Electric Terrain, so it should be doing a bit more damage than prior. Picking up the Paralysis onto the Incineroar, which is a bit unfortunate for my opponent. And we just see Flare Blitz into the Bubble Gun 2, which we're able to take. And that's thanks so much, you know, the parting shot reducing the attack and the special attack stat on the Incineroar as well. So see what my opponent brings in for his next Pokemon. It is the Palisand. So we do need to be a bit careful with this because it will have the, is it the Water Compaction ability that boosts its defense? I'm just gonna go for a recover this turn with my Porygon 2, and I am just gonna go for another Liquidation into the Palisand. And hopefully do some good damage onto it. We should be looking at doing about 50% to the Palisand here. See my opponent withdraw the Incineroar, bring in that Kartana. And a Toxic from the Palisand. And it is into the Porygon 2. Okay. But that's not going to worry me too much because we should be able, even with any defensive boost, we should be able to pick up, easily pick up a 2-hit KO on this Palisand. Yeah, so we do see the defense rise. We get that recovery off. We do need to be a bit careful with this Kartana because, you know, it is going to threaten our Araquanid with a Leaf Blade. But we can hit it for decent damage with an Ice Beam. So we'll just Ice Beam into it. And yeah, I'm just going to go for another Liquidation into that Palisand slot. We might potentially see a Shore Up. Yep, as we do. But even with this, I think we might have enough to be able to actually take it out with the Liquidation. Maybe. I don't know. No. So Palisand showing that that Water Compaction ability is coming in very useful there. Is able to survive the second Liquidation. And I wonder if that is Assault Vest, Kartana. So, we've still got one more turn of Trick Room left. Now, I could go for a recovery with the Porygon 2. I think it will. Oh, what could I do? I could switch in my Persian here, but it is potentially going to take a... I think I'm going to switch in my Tapu Koko. And I'm going to go for a substitute with my Araquanid. Because we get the Trick Room ending next turn, and the Tapu Koko, and it will threaten that Kartana a bit better than what we would have done previously. We're going to reset the Toxic damage as well each turn. So we see the Palisand go for a Shore Up again, just to get some of its health back. We should get a free substitute here with our Araquanid. And hopefully that Kartana went for a Sacred Sword again into the Porygon 2. But it goes for the Leaf Blade this time. So, not the worst situation in the world. Our sub does fade. And that Palisand is going to prove to be so annoying. But we do have the Persian, so it's not the end of the world. Now, I will go for a... I'm going to go for a Thunderbolt. Into the... no, I'm not. Because we could potentially see a... I'm just going to go for a Protect with my Araquanid. And I'm going to go for a Volt Switch into that Kartana slot. I don't want to go for the T-Bolt just yet, because we may see an Earth Power come out from that Palisand. And we don't really want to be taking too much damage with our Tapu Koko right now. So we get the Protect off with the Araquanid. Get the Volt Switch into that Cortana. Yeah, that's definitely Assault Vest Cortana. And we'll bring in the Persian here. And if you hear noise in the background, guys, I'm super sorry. I think my neighbors are like doing some work. So if there's like loud noises and drills and things, whatever, hopefully it's not kind of coming over in the mic too much, but I can definitely hear it. So we see the Leaf Blade into the Araquanid and Protect, and an Earth Power into that what was Tapu Koko slot. So here, I think what I'm going to do is go for a Foul Play, which should be enough to take down that Cortana. And I'm going to go for a Substitute again with my Araquanid. Hopefully the Persian can get through this turn. If we take another Earth Power, it will proc our berry. So we just need to be making sure that we're taking that Cortana down. Hopefully a Foul Play is enough. It should be. But we'll have to see. So do get the Foul Play off into the Cortana. Yeah, and that is enough. So the Cortana does go down. We get the Substitute off with our Araquanid. And we see a Stockpile. Not ideal at all. So boosting its defense even more, and its special defense. This is going to be a real pain to take out. A real pain. We've got the Incineroar to come in now, but we can easily deal with it with our Araquanid. We are behind the sub, so we're not going to take any potential fake out this turn. So I'm just going to switch in my P2 on my Persian. And I'm going to just go for a Liquidation onto that Incineroar slot. We should be able to take out the Incineroar, and then we can put all of our efforts into taking this Palisand down. Which is going to be extremely difficult. Because we've got no Toxic of our own, which would be very handy in this situation. We do see the Fake Out from the Incineroar onto the Porygon 2. We get the Liquidation off and pick up the KO onto the Incineroar. And now it is 4-on-1. So we see another Earth Power come out from the Palisand. Is into the Araquanid. But we are able to take that, and our Substitute staying intact here. Right. So I'm just going to go for a Recover with my Porygon 2, and I'm going to go for a Liquidation into this Palisand. It's not going to be doing very much, but we've got to start doing some damage to it sooner rather than later. Doing hardly any damage, and we're going to boost its defense even more, which is not ideal, but we kind of want it. You see, it's stockpiling. This is the thing, but its defense won't go any higher, so it's just boosting that special defense now. And with the Recover, it's going to be a massive pain to take out. So I think this is one of the things that we're noticing a trend with the team this week as well, is that we've got so yesterday's episode we had massive issues coming down with that Snorlax at the end of the game, and we're having a similar situation here with this Palisand. So it is a familiar trend with the team that we're shown, and it's not able to kind of deal with the stally threats as well as we need it to. So it's definitely something to look at for improving it, to take it forward. So, you know, the inclusion of something like Toxic or something like that might be a lot more handy to have in the team. So we can just Toxic in this situation, and the Palisand will go down after so many turns. But because we're not doing that, it is making it a lot more difficult for us to deal with these Pokemon. We do take an Earth power. Again, it's not enough to break the sub on the Araquanid, and we are getting closer to taking that Palisan down. Although it's probably just going to shore up this next turn, so we can just continue to Ice Beam and Liquidation. You know, it might be enough. We might get a critical hit. It's going to kind of save us the long haul here. But I still feel like we'll be alright. So we do get the Ice Beam, doing decent enough damage, and this Liquidation, is it going to be enough? Oh, and it's so close, it's so close. But we do get the defensive drop. But that's just going to be counteractors, yeah. And we see the shore up here from the Palisand. So we probably will lose our Porygon 2 here to the toxic damage. So we just needed a tiny bit more on our roll from the Liquidation. So I'm just going to go for the Ice Beam again. You know, we've got every chance that we could pick up a freeze as well. Like I say, a freeze or a critical hit or something would kind of just seal the game up for us. So go for the Ice Beam. It's still doing decent enough damage. And get the Liquidation off. But we'll probably see just another shore up here. Drop that defense, but then again, we're going to get the defense boost, so kind of just, yeah. And another shore up from this Palisand. And Porygon 2 definitely will go down here. So we'll bring in the Persian this next turn. And we'll start trying to get some damage off with the foul play. It's not going to be doing too much because of that defensive stat on the Palisand, but it should be doing a decent amount of damage. And the other thing is we can stop it from being able to recover with that shore up. So I will just go for Liquidation again. And Persian should be able to take at least an Earth power. So we're going to get the taunt off. We probably should have done this way earlier in the match as well. So let's see what this... It goes for an Earth Power and it is into the Araquanid slot. So that's fine now. So our substitute eventually fades. But now quite free just to go for foul play, Liquidation, and we should be able to take it out before this Palisand can do really too much more damage to us. So I'm just going to go for the foul play and the Liquidation. Let's see how much this foul play does. Probably not very much at all. Oh, pitiful damage. Yeah. And we should just, one more round, we should be able to pick up the KO here on this Palisand. Oh. So Persian actually goes down there. But we've got a Tapu Koko to bring in, and we've got that Twinkle Tackle still. So we can use that to our advantage. And go for a Liquidation as well. Oh, we haven't got the Twinkle Tackle, we've just got the Dazzling Gleam and a Liquidation. But that should be enough to take this Palisand down. Should be. It's not. It's not going to be great. But I'm confident we should be able to finish this game off this turn, and I'm sure you guys can't wait for me to kill this sandcastle. So, get the Dazzling Gleam off. Yeah, definitely. And the Liquidation will be enough to take down the Palisand. Finally, finally. So, yes. And we pick up a win. So good game to my opponent there. Massively stretched out game. And yeah, I will apologise for that as well, guys. I do want to keep these episodes a lot shorter than I have been. We had the disconnect as well, which kind of totted up a bit more time. But I think the main thing is we need to really reevaluate our thinking process around the team and how we're playing the team. Because at the moment, it's not... it's not fitting as well, and we're getting ourselves into these stupid situations where we're dragging games out and potentially getting ourselves into situations that we could have previously avoided. Like, we could have taunted the palace stand a lot earlier in the game and then taken care of it easier. But things worked out all right in the end. But like I say, there is a kind of a noticeable trend between these bulky Pokemon with recovery, and we haven't really got the resources to quickly and effectively deal with them. And that's maybe something wrong with the team, something wrong with the selection and team preview, or just how I'm approaching matches. So I am still getting used to the team, and that's the main thing I want to kind of put across to you guys. You've got to kind of give yourselves a chance with a team. You don't want to just use it and then put it to one side. I mean, there's nothing wrong with that, but before you do that, you want to get to the point where you've used it and really kind of got to know whether it's going to suit you or not. And I don't feel like we've got there yet. As I say, I don't feel massively comfortable with it, but hopefully as we get to the end of the week, things will get a bit better with that. So I'm going to wrap things up now, guys. Thank you so much for watching. It is always a pleasure to have you company with me here, and I've really enjoyed this episode. It's been a bit shaky, but it's some good lessons to learn, and it's nice to use newer Pokemon. If you've enjoyed the episode, guys, please leave a like on the video. It's massively appreciated. If you're not subscribed to the channel, subscribe to the channel, and you'll get all the daily updates for when these videos and things come out. But until tomorrow, guys, you go away, enjoy the rest of the evenings, and take care of yourselves, whatever you're doing, and I will see you tomorrow. So until then, take care of yourselves, and bye-bye!